Bonjour à tous. Donc, je m'appelle Vincent Lefieux, vous ne me connaissez pas forcément. Je suis en fait impliqué dans les événements Shannon 100 que l'IHP organise. Je travaille dans le domaine de la data science dans un des partenaires de l'IHP qui est RTE, qui est le réseau de transport d'électricité français. Et aujourd'hui, j'ai l'honneur de vous accueillir pour cette conférence au workshop scientifique. Alors Cédric Villani, malheureusement, ne peut pas être là aujourd'hui. Il fera la clôture vendredi, par contre. Voilà, donc il m'a demandé de l'excuser. L'Institut Henri Poincaré, depuis 1928, participe très activement à la recherche scientifique à travers de très nombreuses rencontres internationales, soutient les activités de la communauté scientifique dans le domaine de la mathématique et de la physique théorique. Et ne pas oublier non plus la promotion de ces activités auprès de toute la société, et c'est un des enjeux forts qui se présente aujourd'hui. On assiste actuellement en fait à une double évolution des sciences mathématiques, à la fois une profonde influence des sciences et technologies numériques aujourd'hui dans la partie mathématique, et une part accrue du rôle des mathématiques dans le monde de l'entreprise. À cela, on peut ajouter évidemment d'autres évolutions, comme le développement de nouvelles interfaces entre mathématiques et d'autres domaines, tels que la biologie, la chimie, les sciences de la Terre, mais également la médecine. Enfin, il y a un rapprochement continuel, et sans doute pas terminé, entre les mathématiques appliquées et mathématiques fondamentales. L'Institut Henri Poincaré en fait suit une évolution similaire, à la fois par une rénovation physique, il y aura un bâtiment en face qui permettra d'accueillir la future maison des mathématiques, mais aussi des rénovations en termes de thématiques, notamment un rapprochement avec toutes les sciences numériques. Alors je dois ici souligner la création récente d'un fonds de dotation dans lequel participent le CNRS, l'UPMC, les sociétés savantes que sont la SFDS, la SMILE et la SMF, ainsi que des entreprises à laquelle j'appartiens. Et tout cela me permettra effectivement de voir un point d'orgue que sera la Maison des mathématiques. Et on peut imaginer aujourd'hui que l'événement Shannon 100 qui est organisé ici, eh bien en fait c'est une préfiguration de cette Maison des mathématiques qui ouvrira d'ici quelques années. Alors l'événement Shannon 100, je vais en dire un petit mot, qui est supervisé par Yann Olivier, ici présent, comprend en fait trois aspects. Un aspect qui est le workshop scientifique que Claude vous présentera ensuite et qu'il a organisé. Des conférences grand public qui sont données dans des lieux aussi divers que le Palais de la Découverte, l'espace Pierre-Gilles Lejeune, il y a l'UPMC aussi, enfin, donc il y a différents lieux dans lesquels vous aurez des conférences grand public. Et enfin, une exposition qui tiendra au Musée des Arts et Métiers de décembre à mars. Si je ne m'abuse pas, c'est du 3 décembre au 12 mars. Voilà. Tous ces événements-là, vous les retrouverez dans le flyer qui est là. Donc n'hésitez pas aussi à en prendre d'autres pour les diffuser dans votre entourage. Et vous avez également toutes les informations sur le site Shannon 100.
Merci Vincent. Mon nom est Claude Berge, je suis professeur à Télécom Bretagne. Donc bonjour et bienvenue à ce colloque consacré à Claude Shannon et ses répercussions dans les différents domaines scientifiques. Neil Sloan, bien connu à l'Institut Henri Poincaré pour son encyclopédie des nombres entiers, mais aussi grand spécialiste des codes correcteurs d'erreurs, a déclaré récemment à propos de Claude Shannon: c'est l'un des plus grands esprits du XXe siècle. Sans Shannon, rien de ce que nous connaissons de nouveau aujourd'hui n'existerait. La révolution numérique est née avec lui. Indéniablement, si l'on place côte à côte l'information de Shannon et le transistor de Shockley, on obtient la combinaison scientifique la plus marquante du siècle passé. Et certainement celle qui a eu le plus d'effet sur notre vie de tous les jours. Ces deux inventions, au même endroit, les Bell Labs, la même année, 1948, c'est une prodigieuse coïncidence, n'ont pas cessé de se donner la main tout tout au long des décennies qui ont suivi, pour contribuer ensemble au formidable essor des télécommunications, ce fut le premier chantier, et de l'informatique, et donc de la plupart, voire de toutes les nouvelles technologies. La théorie de la communication, rapidement rebaptisée par d'autres plus enthousiastes que Shannon, théorie de l'information, Shannon était assez réticent sur l'interprétation qui pouvait être donnée de ses travaux en sciences sociales, qui furent les premières disciplines intéressées par la théorie de l'information. Donc la théorie de l'information, disais-je, est une science jeune, à peine 70 ans, à comparer aux 3 ou 4 000 ans des mathématiques, par exemple. Et il est certain que Claude Shannon a fait le plus gros du travail. Cet ingénieur mathématicien, et néanmoins bricoleur et un peu farceur, a fait le plus gros du travail. Le plus difficile pour lui fut certainement de se poser les bonnes questions. Qu'est-ce que l'information ? Puis cerner et formaliser les concepts essentiels, proposer des modèles, établir des théorèmes fondamentaux. Ah, ces fameuses limites de Shannon qui ont fait notamment mon quotidien et que l'on croyait inatteignables. Il a aussi promu, ça on le sait peut-être moins, le calcul digital, l'algèbre de boules, et puis donc en accompagnement du transistor, eh bien, les premières machines électroniques, les premiers ordinateurs. Ce fut une tâche immense. Mais la théorie de l'information grandit, progresse, et notre pays n'est pas en reste. À une anecdote près quand même, je ne sais pas si vous le savez, Google, le 30 avril 2016, pour marquer le 100e anniversaire de Claude Shannon, a créé un Doodle Shannon qui a été émis sur toute la planète et dans l'Europe entière, sauf en France, où ils ont préféré marquer et célébrer les Shaddocks. Et ce qui donne quand même une image de ce que pensent les Californiens sur notre activité scientifique. Bon, je ferme la parenthèse. Et donc, cette science, cette théorie de l'information, on le voit, c'est évident, et on le verra tout au long du colloque, irrigue de plus en plus de domaines théoriques et applicatifs. Les mathématiques, la physique, les neurosciences, la génétique, la linguistique et l'intelligence artificielle plus récemment. C'est cette diversité de liens entre la théorie de l'information et les autres sciences que ce colloque Théorie de l'information, nouvelles frontières se propose de démontrer à travers une série de 13 exposés, très variés, comme vous pourrez l'apprécier tout au long de ces 3 jours. Je remercie par avance les 13 conférenciers qui donneront leur conférence en français aujourd'hui ainsi que demain et en anglais vendredi. Je remercie... Tu vas la donner en anglais alors que ton français est parfait. Mais bon, ok, c'est ton choix. Donc, à quelques exceptions près, les exposés seront donnés en français aujourd'hui et demain. Et je remercie également ceux qui m'ont aidé à programmer ce colloque, Vincent, qui a fait l'introduction, Yann, qui sera le premier directeur de séance, Yann Olivier du CNRS, Aslan Chamkerten de l'Institut Mintelecom, Télécom Paris Tech, Frédéric Barbaresco de Thales et Patrick Flandrin de l'ENS Lyon. Chacun d'entre eux donc dirigera une session tout au long de ces 3 jours. Pour terminer cette commémoration du centenaire de la naissance de Claude Shannon à l'initiative de l'Institut Henri Poincaré, et vraiment la bienvenue pour celles et ceux qui ont fait leur chemin sur les épaules de ce géant. Voilà, Yann, je te donne la parole pour la première session. Si, quand même, quelques remarques pratiques avant de démarrer. Donc, chacun d'entre vous est invité à un buffet ce midi, donc qui sera servi à l'entrée. dans la pièce principale qui vous a accueilli ce matin pour le café, mais également dans d'autres pièces dans lesquelles vous pourrez vous asseoir. Pendant ce temps, l'amphithéâtre sera bouclé, donc vous pouvez y laisser vos affaires. En revanche, cet après-midi, lors de la pause, ça restera ouvert. Donc voilà. Donc ce midi, vous pouvez laisser vos affaires pendant le buffet. Voilà, Yann.
Merci Claude. Et donc on va pouvoir entamer les réjouissances avec le premier exposé. Notre premier orateur aujourd'hui est János Körner, qui vient de l'université La Sapienza de Rome et donc qui va nous expliquer des correspondances assez étonnantes, je dois dire a priori, entre la théorie de l'information et la combinatoire. Je dois aussi ajouter que János Körner a reçu il y a 2 ans le prix Claude Shannon de Information Theory Society, qui est le prix le plus prestigieux dans le domaine, et qui a comme particularité que le tout premier prix Claude Shannon a été donné à Claude Shannon. Je ne sais pas s'il y a beaucoup d'autres instances de prix comme ça, mais en tout cas, c'est une caractéristique très, très rare, je suppose. Et donc, je propose de passer la parole à János Körner.
Alors, vous m'entendez? Et donc, je vais parler en anglais, je m'excuse, mais... Enfin, il y a des tas de raisons pour lesquelles j'ai préféré parler en anglais, malgré le fait que j'adore le français, c'est ma langue préférée. Mais bon. So, now I will switch. Okay? So, I'd like to talk about the legacy of Shannon in combinatorics. So, Shannon as a mathematician, as a very fierce supporter of what is usually called by now curiosity-driven research, has accompanied all my scientific life, and I'm not even sure whether I've written any paper where he was not cited. But that's not so important. So when I am to talk about Shannon's legacy in combinatorics, I will certainly concentrate in an unfair manner on the research I have participated in. But my main objective is to show that starting from a single paper of Shannon, a whole bunch of research was born, and that really structures a good part of combinatorics. And as a matter of fact, I, as a student, heard about Shannon in a graph theory course by Tibor Gallai at the Institut of Mathematics of the Hungarian Academy of Sciences that is now called the Alfred Rényi Institute. Okay. So, I don't want to talk too much about Shannon's life, because I suppose that most of you know more about it than myself, but... mathematical model of Shannon's for communication. It's really kind of a complicated model when you first hear about it, so I have not put up there the usual block diagram of Shannon's that is sometimes called the coat of arms of information theorists. I just wanted to indicate that a channel is something like a black box. It has an input alphabet, and it has an input with an alphabet X, that I will suppose finite because I want to, you know, gear towards combinatorics, and also that is the basic model, I might say. And then it has an output where there is a not necessarily different, but most of the time different, finite alphabet, the output alphabet. And then you have a transition from input to output, and that is driven by a stochastic matrix. Well, I don't know whether I can point in some way. Yeah, maybe it is the, yeah, okay. So, oh no, well, that was not what I wanted. Okay, so it's a stochastic matrix, and and if you use the channel repeatedly, and if you use it n times, then the probability that you will receive the string y, once which has the coordinates 1, y1, y2, etc., yn, when the string x with the coordinates x1, x2, etc., x sub n was transmitted, then this is this product probability that you can see in there. All right. Now, what is the code? Well, I simplify somewhat, but it's really... And then it maps these output strings into the code words. So the range of the decoder function is just the set that was the code word set. And this code, you know, that is there to transmit messages has to be good in some sense. And there, so we have two quality measures for the code. One is, you know, we want to transmit as much as we can, so we want to have a huge code word set. So the cardinality of the code word set is then normalized. Are necessarily there because, you know, in the general case, the transmission of every symbol can result in any output symbol with varying probabilities. But now we want to have a correct decoding. So correct decoding means that actually when you transmit x, then the decoder will decide on x. Okay, and therefore, right. So it's the probability. So phi to the minus n of x is the set of all those output strings for which the decoder decides that x was transmitted, and the conditional probability of this set should be large. And it and capacity, and I just really want to stress that this is complicated. Okay, so this is the maximum rate R, for which there is a sequence of codes such that the code rate is substantially above R. Okay, one doesn't even need this asymptotic sign down there, and at the same time the probability of correct decoding converges to one. So you want to know this maximum rate, which is speed, actually, for which the probability of correct decoding can asymptotically achieve 1. And what is surprising is that despite this rather complicated definition, Shannon found a very, very simple compact formula, I mean, at least by now, simple compact formula for this capacity, this maximum rate. And you can see it there. I won't really use it in the future. So this is just the IPW is the mutual information between input and output if the probability distribution of on the input is P. And this is something that you can vary. W is given to you. That's the channel. Okay? And so it's rather intuitive, but I won't go into this intuition, that the maximum of this mutual information is the capacity. But it was proved, I mean, Shannon guessed it, and he gave intuitive arguments for this. That is usually called Shannon's theorem. And there is no doubt that he could have given a formal proof, but he just did not care. And it was people around Shannon who then, you know, worked out the details. One of these people is just died just recently. This is Robert Fano, or as a matter of fact, Fano. Okay, so he was the son of the Jewish-Italian mathematician geometer Fano, and this is the reason why they ended up in the United States. Okay, all right. So now, in 56, Shannon published a paper. I mean, that was after several other papers, of course. And this paper became extremely important to combinatorics. And that is really the starting point of what I really want to talk about. And this is, you can see, it's very funny how this is a published paper. This is how it was published. So it's like, you know, typed. It's not justified. But this appeared in the IEEE transactions, which was the forerunner of the IEEE transactions on information theory, as IEEE was the forerunner of IEEE. And he just introduced zero error capacity. So it's very simple. I do not really have to go, but I will, go over the details of how it is defined. The only change with respect to what I introduced before, is that now we require the probability of correct decoding to be 1, equal to 1. So no asymptotics is involved here, okay? And now, you know, engineers might argue that zero doesn't really exist, or we don't care. whether the probability of error is zero or just very, very close to zero. But mathematically, this is a dramatic change. So I will explain a little bit what is the zero error capacity of a noisy channel. But the main point is that there is no formula for it, which is a hard statement to make because, you know, formula is not something that you define in mathematics. So what is a formula? That's not so clear. But what is clear that no formula has been put forward for this rather simple quantity. Now here you can see how he introduced this. And it's really wonderful. And it's introduced a very beautiful problem in mathematics. So he explains the ordinary capacity. And then he says, in some situations, it may be of interest to consider, rather than codes with probability of error approaching zero, codes for which the probability is zero, and to investigate the highest possible rate of transmission or the least upper bound of these rates for such codes. This rate, C, note, is the main object of investigation of the present paper. It is interesting, and he does say this, that while C note would appear to be a simpler property of a channel than C, it is in fact more difficult to calculate and leads to a number of as yet unsolved problems. And I can reassure especially the students that these problems are still unsolved. Which doesn't mean that you cannot work around them, and actually this problem and this paper gave birth to an incredible amount of very, very beautiful combinatorial mathematics. And this is what I will explain a little bit. Okay? So now this is the definition. The zero error capacity is the maximum rate such that there is a code sequence with rate that is above R. And once again, this tilde can be suppressed. This is not really important. And the minimum probability of correct decoding is just 1, without any approximation. And now, there is no formula for this R, and this is a very, very unsolved problem. Now, what you can see immediately, and Shannon did see this, and I will let you understand that he did, that this is really, that this can be converted in a problem about graphs. You see, once you have a code word, then all the output strings that can result with a positive, strictly positive probability from that code word must be decoded as that code word. So the decoder is not a problem because it's just the decoding function, the optimal decoding function is defined by precisely this condition. And that simply means that this sets that I denoted by SW, S sub WX, this must be disjoint. Because, you know, if I have to assign an output string that has a positive conditional probability on X to X, then I cannot assign it to any other code word. Mm-hmm. Right? So, and that gives a graph. And this is a graph that depends on the length of the transmission N. And I really define it in a complementary way as with respect to Shannon's, but that's just mathematically equivalent. And you will see why. So in this graph, you have an edge between two input strings, x prime and x double prime, if these support sets are disjoint. So that just gives you a graph. And then, you know, a click in a graph, what is the click? A click is a set of vertices such that you have all the edges between them. And a good zero error code must be a click in that graph. And the largest rate is in function of is just the normalized value of the size of the largest click in that graph, G to the N, that is usually denoted in combinatorics by omega. That's the click number of the graph. Mm-hmm. And now Shannon defined the capacity of a graph in these terms. And actually, the star in his paper was this very, very simple graph, the pentagon graph. Mm-hmm. So in the pentagon graph, the way I describe it, which is complementary to the way Shannon did, is a graph in which the input alphabet has five elements that we might call as well 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And the edges are, you know, between consecutive, I think I'm pointing, but actually, unfortunately, you don't see it. So between consecutive elements. So 0, 1 is an edge, 1, 2 is an edge, 2, 3, 3, 4, and 4, 0. And that's all. So that's the pentagon graph. Okay? Now, a code is just a set of strings, such that between any true strings, so if you think about an edge as distinguishability, as a sign of distinguishability, and then it's normal, but that's the mathematical definition, that two strings are distinguishable if you just, scan them, all right, coordinate by coordinate, and if you find a coordinate in which there is an edge between the two strings, then they can be in a code. Okay? Now, together. And the graph capacity is just the normalized version of the click number of that graph. So it's very simple in combinatorial terms. So omega g to the n is the size of the largest click in that graph that I define. And then you just calculate this asymptotically. You calculate the rate, which is the normalized version of this omega. And that has a limit. It's very simple elementary analysis that it has a limit. And but this is a little lemma of Hungarian mathematician Mihály Fekete. It's usually called Fekete's lemma. That's simply because omega is a super multiplicative quantity. And if you normalize it this way, then it has a limit, just because it's super multiplicative. That's Fekete's lemma. Okay? And so it's easy and well known that the limit exists, but to calculate it is an immense and unsolved problem. Okay? And now here you can see that Shannon formulated this problem in graph terms. And in his paper, the one of which I showed you the initial part, there is a page with these little graphs. And as you can see, this is in complementary terms, but that's not what matters. So you can see that the value of all of the capacity of all of these graphs, the complement of these graphs as I define it, is there. Well, and there is only one case that sticks out. All right, and for this case, which is the pentagon, which you can see, which is the second from the left in the third row, all right? You can see that there are only bounds. So he was not able to determine the capacity of this graph. Now, this is a self-complementary graph, so whether it's the graph or the complement doesn't matter. Okay? So you see that he has a lower bound of square root of 5 and the upper bound of 5 over 2. All right? And this was... the problem remained open with these bounds, and none of these two bounds was improved for almost 25 years. And then there came László Lovász. You know, so this is a fellow Hungarian, so the pronunciation of his name is really László Lovász. And he proved that the upper bound was correct. Now, it's interesting to notice that this upper bound, so for Shannon, it was natural to use as an upper bound ordinary capacity. So for zero error capacity, you are asking for more. And therefore, so you ask for a probability of error to be equal to zero, not just 10 to zero. So therefore, the zero error capacity has ordinary capacity as an upper bound. And but it's in terms of graphs. But so therefore, to the graph you can associate all the stochastic matrices, all the channels of which this would be the graph, right? And so therefore, the minimum of the capacities of these graphs is an upper bound for capacity. And this is how Shannon derived it, and that's the value, the upper bound he obtained, right? And now, so Lovaas proved that that is just tight. And he proved it in a very interesting manner because he represented the graph by vectors in some Euclidean space and represented edges in my version by orthogonality, and then he used normal vectors. So he introduced in this way orthonormal representation of graphs, and that became very important in computer science, in theoretical computer science. And well, I don't want to go into the details of how he did that. So he somehow defined a center to his representation, a central vector, and he minimized the angle, and that is his famous bound, the theta bound of Lovaas's. Now, what's interesting about it from the point of view of information theoretic pride, if you wish, is that if you think about it, if you go back from the graph to the channel, then also the probability distributions associated with the different elements of the input alphabet do give an orthogonal representation of the graph, in which you know, adjacent vertices, so those connected by an edge, are correspond to orthogonal distributions, in the sense that, you know, two distributions are orthogonal if their scalar product is zero, which corresponds to the fact that those support sets are disjoint. So it is an orthogonal representation, and you can show in terms of divergence and center of the vectors in terms of divergence. So you have the vectors representing the elements of the input alphabet, and then you consider as a center a vector for which the maximum divergence is minimized. Well, I should say which way, because the informational divergence or Kullback-Leibler divergence is not symmetric. And you can find this as an exercise in my book with Csizár, and it's actually Csizár who understood this, but I mean, it's hard to find other than in my book. And now comes the French connection. So maybe now I should switch to French, but I won't. Okay. So, and this is a rather recent recollection of Claude Berge's about how he got to know about this problem. So he says that when he heard that I was writing a book on graph theory, my friend Schützenberger, I guess that's the correct pronunciation, drew my attention on an interesting paper of Shannon, which was presented at a meeting for engineers and statisticians, but which could have been missed by mathematicians working in algebra or combinatorics. And here you can see Marcel Schützenberger and Berge, and then Berge with Paul Erdős. Okay. So Claude Berge was the father of graph theory in France. And now what you can notice is that, and that's very easy, that you know, this, the determination of capacity, of graph capacity, that is a very hard problem and for which no formula exists, becomes easy if in the graph two parameters coincide. One is the click number that I have already mentioned, and the other one is the chromatic number. Now, what is the chromatic number, in case someone doesn't know? So you can color the vertices of the graph, and the proper coloring of the vertices of a graph is one in which you assign different colors to vertices that are adjacent. And you can see that these vertices colored blue have the same color, which is okay because they are not adjacent. And so that puts a condition on you know, the number of colors you must use, and you want to minimize this number, and the minimum is called the chromatic number, all right? And so this is a simple observation, and this is really a textbook exercise to show that if over a graph omega and chi, the chromatic number, are equal, then the capacity, if you don't take logarithms, coincides with both of them. But since I defined capacity by taking the logarithm, therefore it's just the capacity is just the logarithm of this click number. Okay. Now Shannon defined. And it's very interesting, and I think it's motivated by somehow this intuition about channels. So Shannon believed that, so we have seen that the coincidence of omega and chi is important in here. Now, if you think that you have a channel, the channel is represented by a graph, but the induced subgraphs of this graph are also important, where induced means that you just consider a subset of the vertices and all the edges that you have in the original graph between this subset of the vertices. Now, if you know this condition of equality of omega with chi is something that is there because of physical reasons, then it's reasonable to consider a graph for which this equality is there also for every induced subgraph. And Berge defined these graphs as perfect. So I'm cheating a little bit because he defined various concepts of perfection, and later on it turned out that they coincide. Okay? So I don't want to tell you the whole story. So Berge, in fact, had a weak perfect graph conjecture, which was very beautiful. He conjectured that a graph is perfect if and only if so is its complement. So a complementary graph is the one in which you just switch non-edges to edges and edges to non-edges. Okay? And so he conjectured this symmetry. And actually, Falkerson developed a whole theory of polyhedral combinatorics to solve this conjecture. And then he gave up and he started to believe that the conjecture was false. And at that time, Berge wrote a postcard to Falkerson. At that time, they used postcards, saying that a young Hungarian mathematician just proved his conjecture. And it is even in the obituary of Falkerson mentioned, I'm not sure I would have included it, that once Falkerson got this postcard, he sat down and found the proof by himself in a couple of hours. That tells you something about the role of psychology in research. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, but Berge also had a strong perfect graph conjecture. And the strong perfect graph conjecture said that the only minimal non-perfect graphs are the odd cycles, cycles of lengths, I mean, of an odd length, and which means that these are cycles having an odd number of vertices. So since this, you already know about the weak perfect graph conjecture, then so if the odd cycles are minimal, then you understand that also their complements are minimal. And Berge conjectured that those are the only two kinds of non-perfect graphs. So every non-perfect graph must have either an odd cycle in there as an induced subgraph or the complement of an odd cycle. And it's interesting to notice that Berge presented this conjecture in a meeting of URSI, which is Union de Radio Scientifique Internationale, I think. Okay? And so, you know, it was a conference for electrical engineers. But Shannon was actually both. Berge was not. But, you know, this conjecture of Berge's actually lived 40 years, which is an enormous amount. And then it was proved in a very long paper. It's almost like 200 pages in Annals of Mathematics by these four people. So Paul Seymour, who is the third from the left, his graduate student Maria Chudnovsky, who was at that time his graduate student. Now she's a professor of mathematics at Princeton. Neil Robertson, a lifetime collaborator of Paul Seymour's, and Robin Thomas, who is a Czech graph theorist, despite the name, that doesn't sound so Czech. Okay. And so, you know, publishing a paper in Combinatorics in Annals of Mathematics is not so common. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, there are related notions of capacity, and so that is what I would like to talk about now. So this concept of graph capacity is the centerpiece of a whole bunch of problems and results in combinatorial mathematics, which is also nice because that if you look at these problems together, then you begin to see a connection between a lot of problems in extremal combinatorics. And so therefore it looks more like a theory. So this was Peter Elias, who actually published some of his most interesting results as footnotes in papers by Shannon. And in 58, he introduced this concept of zero error capacity of a discrete memoryless channel for list code. Now, what is a list code? So a normal decoder, when it receives when it sees a string at the output of the channel, should guess on which code where it was sent. Okay? That's the decoder function. Now, in this variant of the problem, it's generalization, Elias said, well, why should the decoder decide on a single string? Let us give the decoder the possibility of just drawing a list. And then this decoder commits an error if the actual code word that was sent is not on the list, right? And now if you have, so you add this parameter, the list size, for instance, list size 2. Okay, so the decoder has to come up with two code words, of which one was the correct code word that was sent. If that code word is on his list, then it's okay. Then no error is made. Now, you know, I wrote on this problem with Gábor Simonyi. This problem came up, propped up much later. I mean, as an information theory problem, it was not considered by combinatorialists. But then it propped up in theoretical computer science, and it got some interest in theoretical computer science as the problem of perfect hashing. Mm-hmm. And the simplest case of this, which we called with Gábor Simonyi the trifference. And it's really a very, very nice problem, but it's just a special case of what Peter Elias defined. So now, if you have a ternary alphabet, 0, 1, 2 is your alphabet, and then if you consider strings of length n, then you would say that three of these strings are trifferent if they differ at once. So if you see a coordinate in the three strings in which you have the three different values. It doesn't matter which value is where, but at some coordinate, the three should be different. This is why I call it trifferent. And it looks just a very, very innocent problem to decide on the largest size of a subset of these strings such that any three of them are in this trifference relation. All right? Okay. So now here, you cannot say anymore that the limit exists of this largest size. So we just take the logarithm as usual in information theory, normalize by the length, and ask for the limit superior. So this is the largest rate. Remember that this really is a problem. I mean, this particular one, if you have a channel, a 3x3 channel, I mean the matrix is 3x3, and the diagonal elements are all zero, and the off-diagonal elements are, say, 1/2. And then you ask for the, you know, the capacity for list size 2 for that channel, zero error capacity of list size 2, then that's exactly this problem. But if you tell about this problem to a combinatorialist talking about channels and noise, he will just walk away. But so I like to emphasize that this problem is really intriguing in its in what I like to call its naked beauty. Okay, and we considered this problem with Cathy Martin, who, by the way, got the Shannon Award in 2013. And well, the upper bound here was already in Peter Elias's paper. These guys in theoretical computer science didn't know about the Elias bound, and they found a bound that was worse. But this is just very simple, the upper bound. Now, the lower bound is somewhat interesting, because here is an example in really Shannon theory where random choice is not optimal. So I want to explain this a little bit. Now, there is this sync tetracode which Sloan wrote about. And this is, it's very well known, this tetracode. This is just a remarkable little combinatorial construction of nine ternary strings, okay, that have uniform Hamming distance 3. And as a consequence of this fact that they have uniform Hamming distance 3, these are trifferent. And it's actually the best construction that you have for different sequences of lengths n over a ternary alphabet. So it's optimal. You can prove that it's optimal. But you can also translate this problem in terms of hypergraph capacity. I won't explain what it is. You can guess. So, you know, a graph is a uniform hypergraph, meaning that all the hyper edges have cardinality 2. But in a hypergraph, the edges can have different cardinality. And it's just very natural. I won't tell you how the definition goes. But the point is that if you consider the simplest conceivable hypergraph that is not a graph, so then that hypergraph has just 3 vertices and a unique edge that comprises all these 3 vertices. And then by the formal definition of hypergraph capacity, you come to this, you go come back to this problem I just mentioned of trifference. So that also is very simple. Here you have the definition. And like I said, what I like about such problems is that they give an unexpected homogeneity to extremal combinatorics. Now, I would like to go a little bit further and talk about a result of mine with some colleagues that really also goes back to zero error capacity of a graph or a channel. And this has its roots in what was Erdős's favorite problem in what he called extremal set theory. And this is Sperner's theorem. And Erdős liked to mention that when he met Sperner, who was by then interested in different things, and he would tell him about his theorem and how he generalized it in various ways, Sperner wouldn't remember. So apparently he didn't care. But so what is the Sperner family? So you have a set of n elements, and you consider subsets of this set. And you would say that they form a Sperner family if no two contain one another. Okay. And so the Sperner's theorem is about the maximum cardinality of such a family of subsets of a set. Now, it's very easy to see that if all your subsets have the same cardinality, then they do not contain one another. And so there is here a unique optimum, and it's just all the sets that have cardinality n half, if n is even. And now you have two families if n is odd, but they are complementary. So it's essentially the same construction. So the hard part of the proof is to prove, well, it's not so hard, is to prove that these pure families in which all the sets have the same cardinality are optimal. Okay? Now we define Sperner capacity. That is just a plain, straightforward generalization of Shannon's graph capacity. You just consider directed graphs. And then you consider direct. So directed graphs mean that edges are not simply unordered pairs of vertices, but they are ordered, and every edge has a beginning and an end. Okay, so it's an arrow. And now, what generalizes this, the concept of click is what I would call a symmetric click. So in a symmetric click, you have the two edges directed in opposite way between any two edges, and between any two vertices, I'm sorry. And then you want to know, you know, in a normal graph, you might not have even one pair of vertices, so that you would have these oppositely directed edges between them. But in the powers of the graph, you would always have them. And the question is, you know, how the asymptotics of this grows. And once again, for the same reason as before, this limit exists. Now, I introduced this concept with Gabor Simonyi in 1992 in a paper, and we called it Sperner capacity for the very simple reason that if you consider the simplest directed graph on Earth, in which you just have two vertices and, you have just two vertices and a single edge directed no matter which way between the two, then a symmetric click just corresponds to the characteristic vectors of a Sperner family. So simply, you know, this capacity is just the asymptotic rate of the largest Sperner family, which is absolutely a trivialization. So it's not interesting in this case because you have the non-asymptotic value by elementary simple combinatorics. But that's only for this graph. Now you can consider just arbitrary graphs, so a twofold generalization. On the one hand, you have an arbitrary graph, and on the other hand, directed graph, and on the other hand, you have a whole family thereof, which corresponds, once again, this is information theory, a family of graphs corresponds to the compound channel. Okay? So what is a compound channel? It's a channel of which you do not know the transition matrix. But you do know that it is one out of a finite number of alternatives. And then you want to consider a set of vertices that forms a symmetric click in every member graph in the family. And you ask the same asymptotics. And this is something that we introduced with Gérard Coin, ici présent, and Gabor Simonyi. And then we continue to work on this, and we actually found a rather simple formula. So once you know the capacity of the single directed graphs, and you know something a little bit more, which I won't explain in detail, but it's something that also came up in standard information theory. So what corresponds to capacity in fixed composition. So it means that you do not consider arbitrary strings, but you fix a distribution and you consider strings such that the relative frequencies of the symbols from your alphabet is according to this distribution. And then you do some approximation that's only technical because of arithmetical reasons, but actually we use this capacity in a fixed composition, or as we call it, types, in a paper with Imre Cisár about the arbitrarily varying channel. So all this really comes from, how should I put it, genuine information theory. Okay? But once you know these technical quantities for the single channels, then in terms of those, we found a very, very simple formula. And now if your individual channels are just one edge, have one edge graphs, which is the original Sperner problem, then this formula really becomes a very simple max-min formula as we are used to in information theory. Now, this really solved a problem that remained open for 20 years. I'm about to finish. This is the problem of Rényi's about qualitatively independent partitions. So Rényi, in a posthumous book that is called Foundations of Probability, considered in the beginning that part of probability theory in which you do not have probabilities. So if you have two random variables that must be independent, then the partitions of the ground space they generate must be what Rényi called qualitatively independent, which means that all classes of the one intersect, have a non-empty intersection with every class of the other. Otherwise, you know, these variables could not be independent. But this is not, there are no quantities involved. This is just qualitative, all right? And so what Rényi asked as a question was, given a set, how many qualitatively independent, how many pairwise qualitatively independent partitions can live on that set? And that's exactly the special case of the general result we had that I put there. Okay? So that solves Rényi's problem. Just one more slide. Well, here are a little bit of references to the problem. Well, I just stop because I guess my time is over. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I don't know what to do here.
Well, thank you for this far-reaching talk with a lot of history and a lot of mathematics as well. Are there any questions in the audience? Okay, so let's thank the speaker again.